Talking to the Dead, Chapter 13. In this particular chapter, we're going to speak about control, which is yet just another energy like all the others. It is truly a fear-based energy, and we'll delve a little bit more into that once we level set in the story of Kelly, how it's played out. Again, sharing stories in this way allows the deepening to occur. It gives the listener something tangible to equate to, which then allows the listener to be able to see how it's fit in their own unique soul plan. In the story of Kelly, and with the guidance here of her departed loved mother, Charlene, their relationship was never an easy one. From birth, Kelly did not receive any bonding with Charlene. She was cast away, pushed away, not intentionally by any means, because Charlene was not a bad or an evil person at all. She was confused. She was unsure, and she played her soul plan part perfectly. She brought forward what was agreed to. There's no anger here with Charlene, and there's no anger here towards the way that it needed to be. There's just a sharing in this moment by the story of Kelly, and a beautiful collapsing of all of the old resentments and angers that once were a part of the story. Part of what led up to her killing herself, having a near-death experience, and being able to step on the other side of that and see it with clarity. So as always, we'll level set a little bit with a story that allows you to tangibly tap into it a little bit with some meaning. When Charlene was pregnant with her second child, she was intending to have a boy. That was what her husband Kevin wanted, one of each. It was what they had always reminisced about in their high school love affair, which became a marriage. And Kevin desired one boy and one girl. They even picked the name Michael Scott. So as the girl came first in Kelly's sister Kim, perfectly and beautifully, when Charlene became pregnant with the second child, it was only ever expected Michael Scott would be there. Yet, as we all know, when we make plans, God laughs not at us, but with us. For he, the energy of it, we us, knows better than we what is needed, and the soul plan carries it forward. 9 months later, enters little Kelly. She came out with a cord wrapped around her neck. So from the very beginning, as a blue baby who almost didn't make it, her entry into this lifetime was a painful one. She arrived blue. She was not crying. And she had to be worked on to come back into that little body. But when she did, and she was held and loved, don't get me wrong, there was also disappointment there, which was very palpable. She did not bond with her mother, nor did her mother bond with her. The fear and the resentment was there. Immediately in her first breath, immediately in her new body, she knew, I am not welcome here. Or at least that's how it was perceived. Already, the conditioning and the belief pattern set in right with the new breaths. She was given the name Kelly Lynn. She was named after her great-grandmother, Callie. And as she is part Brazilian and part Irish, It was named after her mother's mother, Callie. And as that Gaelic name was gifted to her, she began her journey with Kevin and Charlene. She knew from a very, very early age she was different. She was unique. And she entered with wonder, always wanting to make others feel loved. In the story of Kelly, I can remember before even having other memories of wanting others to feel loved. Before I even had language, if I found something beautiful, I ran to give it to another. I wanted them to feel the same joy I felt when I discovered it. Perhaps it was just a little buttercup in the field. I'd run, I'd give it to my mother. And yes, she would smile and accept it. There wasn't an unkindness there that was intentional, but there was a boundary there that was very much felt. Charlene was a beautiful sewer, so she would make all of our clothing, or most of it, by hand. My sister was dressed always in beautiful girly pink things and adorned. Kelly was dressed in blue, often like a little boy. Her hair was cut in a page boy style often, with really short clipped bangs. And her sister was always adorably dressed with beautiful long hair and long curtain soft bangs. Again, this wasn't intentional on Charlene's part, nor was it unkind deliberately. Yet that's how it was received and perceived in the story of Kelly. I am not welcome here. I am not loved here. I am not adored here. Fast forward to the age of 3, where Kelly was allowed to go off with her grandfather, her mother's father, the one who had once molested her own mother. And we know how that played out. We don't need to go there yet again. Nor are we sharing this so that listeners feel sorry for anything that happened, because it is all part of the soul plan and story, and there's zero resentment or bitterness here now. We're able to share this so that you, the listener, can see how this translates as a gift. It's very hard to understand that any of what I just shared could be a gift, yet it is. In that detachment, in that lack of bonding, little Kelly found her inner power from a very young age. She went inward without knowing that's what was happening. She sought the bigger, united we us and asked for help over and over, over and over, over and over. For 38 years, she was a victim of her own life. Everything seemed to be happening to her, not for her, and that, too, was part of the soul plan. You see, what is written in this soul plan is to guide us and unite us with the we us. The deepening and the unraveling is in recognizing that not any of it, not one iota of it, is true. The no is always pointing to the yes. It may take 38 years to be able to recognize this. And that's okay, because time and space is part of the illusion, as we've declared. Charlene is now one of Kelly's biggest advocates. She is, in fact, such a loving soul. She carried out some of the most arduous and painful stories in Kelly's book of Unfolding in Life. She did so with the purest intentions. That guidance of no guidance was what was needed. That bonding of no bonding was what was intended. That disruption versus engagement was exactly the gifts that were asked for. And in doing so, this now version in the story of Kelly is able to receive and perceive only the truest of love from that which she refers to as her mother. There's no longer confusion here for either of us. There's just unconditional love. For 30 some years, that played out until Charlene left the body. But Kelly was so grateful to get to heal all of it before she transitioned. They were able to say all they needed to say, to heal all that was needed to be healed. Nothing ever needed to be forgiven, yet even that did itself. I realize some of you listening now may not have had this in your own unique stories. Maybe someone's departed and you didn't get to have that unraveling. So we're going to talk a bit about how you can do that and how this control stuff is just yet another energy, a fear energy, that also just wants to be enlightened. Enlightening any energy, whatever we call it, is as simple as inviting it in. It's about acknowledging it into the awareness, being so aware that the control is fear-based, and saying, this is the old, the new wants to come in. I surrender it because I don't understand it, and I don't need to. God Squad, help me to see this unravel. I know that it's control, fear-based ways of being, trying to toggle the toggles, wanting to be the puppet master, wanting to own the outcomes, wanting to pull or push the experiences, all of them perfectly doing themselves, until the earnest willingness to say, I let it all go. I collapse here. I release. I surrender. Show it the new way. Allow it to deepen here in the love that it is in truth. That is how it transmutes. It is letting go of the thing that thinks it needs to hold on so tightly. Control never feels good. To be the giver or the receiver. True and authentic unconditional love says, I don't know where this is going. I can't see the other side of this, but that's okay. I just want to feel loved right here, accepted right here, and only this me, can do that. Certainly I can ask for validation and signs that the guidance is truly taking hold. We need that in the 3D. It sometimes gives us the momentum to keep moving towards that which feels so very painful. Don't be afraid to say, God Squad, bring me signs and validations that this surrender is truly bringing the new forward. I want the control to let go so that it too can be love, so that it too can come into the light, so that it too can allow fear to become a united force of energy of love. It isn't about trying to control the control, but using the control to heal the control. For all the toggles turned inside out are the drivers of energy to bring forward the love. It simply cannot be any other way. Once it rejoices in the roomy guest house, where it belongs, it too becomes a palpable, joyful energy you're able to share intimately with others in their own apparent stories of control. Not by doing something, but by being something. Showing up in that unconditional love transmutes that for those apparently struggling with it around you. It's not the words you say, or the teachings you offer, or the lessons you've learned. As you, the listener, know, you also received those on your journey, and they didn't seem to take hold. Or perhaps they did for some short time, until it fully let go. That transparency will do itself, just as it has in the story of Kelly. Yet, control still arises. Jealousy still arises. Anger still arises. It just no longer sets up camp here. It is invited back home. Confusion is no longer necessary. Healing is not needed. Enlightenment to the confusion is all that's needed. Be kind, gentle. Be authentic, genuine, to you, for you, in this. And then, and only then, can you seem to offer that to others. Much love. Until next time.